Hello and welcome to the forum. I'm Michael Fontroy. The searing images from Iraq's Abu Ghraib prison showing American servicemen and women torturing and humiliating Iraqi prisoners drew worldwide condemnation. With us to revisit that era is James Piffner, the author of Torture as Public Policy, Restoring U.S. Credibility on the World Stage. Jim, welcome to the forum.
Thanks very much, Mike, for having me.
Well, listen, this is a great topic. It's one that crosses a bunch of different boundaries. At one level, it's about politics. At another level, it's about culture. But it's also about the sort of common humanity that one should show for another. And so with that, I want to begin with a very basic question to get us started, to make sure everyone's on the same page, and that's simply this. What is torture?
Well, it's taken different forms over the ages, and, just about every civilization did, but certainly the Greeks did, the Romans did, medieval times, they had torture to get people to confess. The Grand Inquisition had used torture to get people to confess to heresies and so forth. And in probably every war that's happened, there have been incidents of torture. Soldiers have done it. All American wars, I'm sure, soldiers did it. But there's a big difference between the occurrence of torture and a policy of torture. If there's no policy, if it's against the policy and people do it, you know, you punish them and so forth. But then the definition you asked, and I'll read the legal definition here in U.S. law. An act committed by a person acting under the color of law specifically intended to inflict severe or mental, physical or mental pain or suffering upon another person within his custody or physical control. So you have this severe pain and it's intentional. Somebody is under your control and you're doing it very deliberately. And of course, the legal advisors in the Bush administration tried to define that away.
Now we know that there are international agreements on torture going back for quite some time. Most notably is the Geneva Convention. Talk a little bit about the Geneva Convention and what it says about torture.
Okay, well first a little bit about U.S. policies, mm-hmm. and George Washington very explicitly forbade torture. Abraham Lincoln had a lawyer named Lieber put together the Lieber Code, which was forbade torture. Now, of course, torture happened, but these policies were against it. So then moving forward, military professionals realized that if everything is okay, then whenever any military forces capture somebody, they're liable to torture them to find out intelligence or just retribution and so forth. And so military got more professionalized in the early 20th century, there was the Hague Conventions, and then in 1949 after World War II, the Geneva Conventions to make sure that torture was not used. And so the Geneva Conventions explicitly prohibit torture. And they have a section, one of the Article 3 of Geneva is about prisoners of war. And that means people who are wearing badges and clearly identified as military people and not hiding behind civilians and so forth. That's a POW status in which you've got to treat them in a certain way. But you don't have to be a prisoner of war in order to make it illegal against Geneva to torture people. And there's a common Article 3 in all of the Geneva Conventions which says anytime you have somebody under your control, you've got to treat them decently, humanely, and you cannot torture them or humiliate them or degrade them. So Geneva applies to all of those things. In the United States, even in the Philippines War, the United States prosecuted U.S. military officers for using torture. And of course, people say this was a 9/11 was a terrible thing and we're under threat. Certainly, I don't want to underplay that. But we had World War II, which was a serious threat. We had the Cold War, which is a serious threat. We had Korea, Vietnam, the first Gulf War, and so forth. And in none of those wars was there a policy that favored torture. This was an exception to U.S. History and practice.
So we have this long recorded world history in which torture has been used. Going back to George Washington, we've seen presidents say, no, this is unacceptable. It is against our rules of engagement to engage in torture. But yet, torture continues. does torture work, and why are we still seeing it being used centuries on if it doesn't?
Well, that depends on what you're using torture for. Certainly to humiliate, degrade, as a sadist, to get revenge and so forth, it certainly works at that level. But the explicit excuse or reasoning behind the Bush administration's use of these harsh techniques was to get intelligence. That is, who knows when the next 9/11 may be coming. These people that we capture probably know, and so we should use what, in order to protect the American people, we should do whatever we can. And I don't want to downplay the threat of 9/11 or continuing threat of terrorism. And I don't want to downplay the fear in the country and the fear at the top of the Bush administration right after 9/11. They could be excused for a lot of things. But the problem was that this policy kept on through the years, even after people pointed out what was happening and so forth. You asked, does it work? In a sense of, you know, first there's the question of, is it moral?
Wait, let me just say, does it work in terms of gathering legitimate intelligence that actually means something beyond just the sort of retribution as you related to earlier?
Right, and so the two key questions, is it legitimate, does it work? The does it work part, is it, it's a question of efficacy. Certainly most people thinking about this, if I thought about it, somebody's gonna torture me, I'd tell them anything. But the key, and this often happens, but the key is anything. Anything to stop the pain. There have been a number of scientific studies, particularly on in 2005, the administration gathered, or the Defense Department gathered together all of these national security experts on interrogation and so forth. You know, came up with a 300-400 page report that said that there's no evidence that torture is a reliable way to interrogate people. And one of the keys is that people cannot tell when other people are lying. So there's been a lot of psychology research in the United States to be able to detect, you know, are you, you know, blinking your eyes, you look nervous, and all of these things. And basically the conclusion is you can't tell if somebody is lying. Okay, so you're torturing somebody and they say, well, you know, there's attack planned, or the bad, you know, my colleagues are over there or over someplace else, or I did do this, I didn't do that. There's no way to really tell whether they're telling the truth or not. And that's a major problem if you're going to resort to something like torture. You can't tell if they, you know, when you've got the answer that you want.
But I'm a decision maker. It's my responsibility to protect the country. And there may be a circumstance in which there's a very short time to act on something. There's a time bomb, for example, that's somewhere, and we feel the only way we can get this information out of them is to engage in torture. Is that acceptable?
Well, that's the ticking time bomb scenario. And it's certainly very plausible on the surface, because you say, oh, there's a big bomb in New York City, it's going to go off, unless we get the information from this guy who knows where it is. And in that kind of, if that were genuine and that were the way things worked in the real world, we'd have to say, well, you know, you've got to consider it. But take a look at this ticking time bomb scenario a little bit closer. First, we have to know that there's a bomb. If we don't know that there's a bomb, then we're, you know, torturing somebody on speculation. Maybe they know. So we've got to know that there is one. And secondly, we have to know that we have the right person. Does this guy know where the bomb is? And we've got to have a lot of confidence, or just sort of, well, maybe this person knows. In addition, this person has to be willing to talk about it and to tell us the right answer. First of all, the person has to have the information in their head, because if you're a shrewd intelligence organization, you compartmentalize things. You know, as soon as somebody is captured, you just assume that they're going to be tortured and tell everything. So you don't tell them everything, too. So the person might not know. And even if the person does know, they may be tough enough to stay under torture for a while. Or they may say, well, the bomb is over on, you know, 43rd and 7th. Okay. What do you do? It's going to take time to go over there and check it out. You keep torturing the guy while you're doing that. So there can be a lot of wild goose chases involved in it too. And torture has to be the only way to get this information. That there's other ways of interrogating people. Then finally, if you do get the right answer you want, you have to have the time to go find it, and you've got to have the means to defuse it. Now, people putting together bombs very cleverly can make it very difficult to defuse it. Okay, so if any one of those conditions that I've just talked about is not there, torture is not the way to solve that problem. So as a hypothetical in a philosophy class, the ticking time bomb scenario might lead somebody to say we should consider torture. But in the real world, nobody's come up with an example of that really happening. Certainly the Bush administration didn't claim that something like that happened. And so that's the problem of justifying it with that kind of seemingly plausible scenario.
But as you know, some of the defenders of the administration, particularly in the sort of communications world, have painted the ticking time bomb scenario as a legitimate defense for torture and have almost elevated it to some level of equivalency with some of the other more legitimate, more likely real world scenarios. So, you know, how has that happened? How is it that we're able to end up in a circumstance in which a scenario that is probably not ever likely to happen is offered as a legitimate defense for this action?
Because the scenario is so seducing, because people would say, yeah, if that's the case, gosh, you know, it may be wrong, but we've got to do it. But what the administration usually has said is that we got valuable information because of this. We've saved lives and so forth. And no doubt they did get valuable information about Al-Qaeda, how it's structured, and so forth. The question is torture the only way to get that information? And if you say, well, anytime you get good intelligence information, it's okay to torture people, that just opens it up to you capture somebody, you figure they probably know something, so torture is okay. And the same thing with the military. Anytime you capture somebody in an opposing force, they might know what's going to happen tomorrow, where the next ambush is going to be, and so that would justify torture for anybody that you capture in any tactical kinds of situation. And that's why the military has been so careful and insistent on enforcing the Geneva Conventions that you can't use torture, it's illegitimate.
One of the reasons why I wanted to have you here to talk about this is not just because you've literally written the book on this topic, but also you served in war zones in both Vietnam and Cambodia. And I'm really interested in your own personal sort of experiences and if you have any, and your personal sort of visceral reaction to the notion of torture. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I guess part of my motivation came from sort of a visceral. I was never captured or tortured. But if you're out there laying in a ditch in a jungle, you don't know if you're gonna be captured. And you can say, oh my gosh, if I am, I sure don't want to be tortured, and I don't want the other side to have any excuse to torture me. Now, certainly, our enemies often don't abjure torture. Certainly, the North Vietnamese tortured people, notably John McCain, very viciously and terrible and so forth, and that certainly wasn't justified. But part of my reaction was, this might happen to me, and I really don't want them to have any excuse. And in terms of U.S. policy, they wouldn't.
Now, when you were serving, did you know about anyone who had been captured and tortured?
No, I didn't.
Okay. So let's flash forward. 35 years later, 40 years later, 35 years later, the photos come out of from Abu Ghraib. They're an international firestorm. There's condemnation all over the place. What was your first reaction to seeing those photos?
My first reaction was, these are a bunch of sadistic kids taking pleasure in, you know, doing those humiliating and torturing people. But after I learned more about it, I did some research and found out it looked a lot more systematic. This was a policy, not that the Abu Ghraib stuff itself is a policy, but this it came out of policies that were very conscious. The kids at Abu Ghraib, they were military police people, which were just supposed to take care of prisoners, but the military intelligence would then take them away and interrogate them. But the MI, military intelligence people, told the MPs, rough these people up, make it miserable for them, soften them up for our interrogations. And that's where those photographs came from. The interrogations themselves, though, used some of these terrible techniques also.
Now, you just used the word policy, okay? So, and which is also the part of the title of the book, and I want to hit on that now. How do we know that this was actually the policy of the United States government?
Well, that's a very important thing, because a bunch of random people doing torture is one thing, but having a policy is another. So looking at what the Bush administration was doing, there are several key decision-making points. One was in November 2001, November 13th, the military commission order that President Bush signed, which created the unlawful enemy combatant category and said that they could not get into civilian courts through habeas corpus and so forth. The second thing was in January and February 2002, President Bush deciding to suspend the Geneva Conventions. Now, this is something that was advised by his counsel, because they were afraid that some people might get prosecuted for this. Colin Powell, the Secretary of State, wrote and said, this is not a good idea. This is not going to work. It's going to put our people at risk. It's wrong. It's illegal. We shouldn't do it. So he reacted to that, but nevertheless, President Bush decided to issue an executive order suspending the Geneva Conventions. The third was the Bybee U memo of August 1st, 2002. And that was a legal memo, but what it did was to allow a whole range of things. And let me just read. We talked about what torture was before, and the way they got around it by, you know, justifying it was saying that instead of the kinds of things that we see as torture, in order to be torture, the actions would have to be equivalent in intensity to the pain accompanying serious physical injury, such as organ failure, impairment of bodily function, or even death. Now, you can tell, you can do an awful lot of things to somebody before reaching that threshold. So what they did was to raise a threshold to allow all sorts of things that most people in the world would consider torture. And then finally, Donald Rumsfeld issued a memo in December 2002, which allowed a whole range of techniques which were not in the Army Field Manual. Army Field Manual is set up to be comply with the Geneva Conventions, and it's not easy. They have all sorts of interrogation techniques, but none of them amount to torture, and Rumsfeld allowed, by signing this memo, a bunch of techniques that went over the edge into what many consider torture.
Now, this doesn't all just happen in a vacuum, these events during 2002. They're in response to something, and that's the September 11th, 2001 attacks. How do you think the attacks shape the thinking of the decision makers within the White House and the Defense Department on the response to the terrorist attacks and sort of reaction and response to anything that could happen going forward?
I think the reaction of the White House, of course, was fear and the determination to protect the United States people from further attacks. That's understandable, and that's good. But at the White House level, they decided we are going to have to go beyond the usual sorts of interrogation techniques and so forth to be able to protect the American people. And so they started these policy decisions. Now, interestingly, on Geneva Conventions, the military officers, particularly JAG lawyers, objected to this. I mentioned Colin Powell, but other people in the military and the Pentagon wrote memoranda, and these are all open on the record, saying this is a bad idea, it's illegal, we should not do it, it's wrong, and it's going to look real bad in the press in the world. And so the Bush administration was warned all along by professionals in the military. And the key to, it wasn't, you say, 9/11 may have started it, and I agree, and if it was just something for a few months after 9/11, they overreacted, not a problem, everybody would understand that. But they were warned first, as I just mentioned, and then they were warned during these things were happening, particularly the Abu Ghraib photographs, so that they knew that this stuff was happening now. They decided not to try to stop it, and they were warned after a lot of these things happened, and they still refused to change the policy. And that's why I conclude that it was a policy and not just sort of just happened by chance.
Now, you mentioned Secretary of State Colin Powell. others in the Pentagon and other places writing and saying this is not the way to go. But there are people on the other side of that who are saying actually this is the way that we need to go. So let's name a few names. Who are some of the people that were involved in sort of pushing these new tactics, writing the supporting documents, and helping to sell it to the country?
Okay, and this is really a case of political control of the career military, which is the way it is in the United States, and that's the way that it should remain. But most of the people in the military, or many people at the top, objected to it. On the other hand, you can always find people in any organization like the military who agree with you and say we've got to get tough and it's worth doing. And so at the top, it's Vice President Cheney and President Bush, David Addington, Cheney's lawyer. In the Office of Legal Counsel at the Justice Department, it's Jay Bybee, but he probably just signed the memos written by John Yoo. Jim Haynes was a counsel to Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld, and he pushed this policy, and some of the other political appointees in the Defense Department did it. And so they made sure that this went through. They got the people to, U.S. people who do the SEER training for U.S. people, U.S. troops, to come in and train troops. So those are the people at the top that made it happen.
So there are people on the inside saying we should do this, and there are also people on the inside saying we shouldn't do it.
That's right.
Ultimately, we know who won the argument on this, and among the things that come out of all of this is some new terminology that I think is pretty curious. I want to sort of get your reaction to. One of the things that I became aware of for the very first time hearing this was this phrase, enhanced interrogation techniques. And in retrospect, I'm skeptical, you know, that it was nothing more than a marketing term. But, you know, I haven't followed this as closely as you have. So what was that term? Where did it come from? Who created it? You know, how was it used and so on?
Well, I'm not sure who initially created it, but it's a term that's used for interrogation techniques that go beyond Army Field Manual or the usual sorts of things, good cop, bad cop, all sorts of techniques you can use in interrogating people that are not torture. But these go beyond that, and some of them don't amount to torture, slapping somebody a bit, sleepless for 24 hours, that's, you know, not torture. But they grade over into things that are torture, sleep deprivation for 4, 5, 6 days, isolation for 30 days, stress positions, extreme temperatures, very hot, very cold, and so forth. Those are called enhanced interrogation techniques because, of course, they don't want to call them torture, and many people in the world would call a lot of that torture, even though some of the techniques don't amount to it.
Now, how did this list of things come together? You know, they go beyond the Army Field Manual, but they had to come from somewhere. Was this the list that that was developed by you?
No, the list, the key list of techniques was put together when Rumsfeld wanted to bring in our soldiers that might be shot down, pilots and so forth. They go through this simulated torture just so that they would know what might happen to them to train them. And this these techniques were developed by a guy named Alfred Biderman after the Korean War. During the Korean War, the Chinese and the North Koreans captured U.S. pilots, and they confessed all sorts of stuff that they did not do. They confessed falsely to using biological warfare and so forth. And so, you know, Biderman said, now, why did this happen? How did they get to the point where they said these falsities? And so then he debriefed, he talked to these people and came up with all of these techniques. And he put them together in Biderman's chart. And this is a way to get people to confess falsely. And then the U.S. Defense Department takes those, or people at the top, take those techniques and use them as a technique for eliciting information, which they were not designed to do, and ironically, of course, were developed by the communists. We used those same sorts of techniques on the people that we captured.
The subtitle of your book is Restoring U.S. Credibility on the World Stage. How badly damaged was U.S. credibility during all this?
I think it made a big difference because we were supposed to be the good guys, you know, above all of that. And those searing images of Abu Ghraib just infuriated and inflamed a lot of people. Now, you can imagine when the United States soldiers were dragged through the street in Somalia, or U.S. contractors in Fallujah, we get really upset if we see our people or even their dead bodies disrespected.
Yes.
And so can you imagine if it was U.S. people being humiliated and tortured like that, and we saw images of it, imagine what our reaction would be. It would be furious. And so that reaction to some people in the world that don't wish us well, and certainly the extremists, pushes some people over the edge from being sort of don't like the United States to being willing to risk their lives to do terrible things to us.
So we have a new president. A president who campaigned on moving us away from this kind of activity. How do you assess the Obama administration to this point with regard to torture, intelligence gathering, and so on?
With respect to torture, I think it's pretty clear. On the 22nd of January 2009, he signed executive orders that said, you know, we will not use this either in the military or in the CIA. And some proponents of the CIA leaned on him, said, don't constrain us that much. There's other things we can do. But he said, no, you've got to comply with everything in the Army Field Manual. And I'm confident that that's what our military is doing. And also, incidentally, the military wanted to get out of this. They wanted to pull back and revise, go back to the Army Field Manual and Geneva. And they did that in 2006. And they feel good with that. With respect to the detainees, however, President Obama has said, well, some of those we're going to have to detain indefinitely and so forth, using state secrets so when somebody sues, no, we've got to shut down that case for national security reasons. So in terms of executive power, President Obama is going as far and sometimes further than President Bush did. But with respect to torture, that's pretty clear, cut and dried now.
So do you think that these efforts are beginning to restore U.S. credibility on the world stage?
Well, I hope so, yes. I mean, I think that the change in tone and so forth has helped the United States a lot throughout the world. But those images still sort of linger. And if somebody wants an excuse to torture people, you know, they can say, well, there's terrorists out there and we've got to do it. And besides, the United States did it back then.
Okay. Well, Jim, thank you very much for sitting with me and talking us through. And thank you all very much for watching. Please tell a friend about the forum. Until next time.